Welcome, myself Mamta. Today we'll be doing chapter 2, Self and Personality. Today we'll be covering the projective techniques and we'll be talking about the behavioral analysis. Let's start with the projective techniques. Now, projective techniques has been taken from the word projection of the psychodynamic theory, where projection basically is from the unconscious when the person is reflecting thoughts outside onto somebody else or onto the outside stimulus. So projective techniques are basically dealing with the unconscious measurement, that is the thoughts, the conflicts, the emotions and the desires. Now these techniques are different from the self-report measures because they are very, very unstructured. Now a particular stimulus is not clearly defined. So the person who is doing the test cannot understand what the psychologist is trying to measure. And that is the beauty of these tests. These tests do not have any right or wrong answers because they are assessing the quality of the unconscious mind. So the qualitative responses is what is valued here. Also, a lot of training is required to do these tests. Very rigorous training, expertise, specialization and experience is required to conduct these tests. Now, these tests also are very subjective in terms of its interpretation, where these tests are having the meaning of being drawn out of the person's unconscious mind. Now, also we talk about the reliability concept here. When we say that a self-report measure should be very reliable, whereas projective techniques are not very reliable. And that is again the positive aspect of it, because a reliable test means it has quantitative objective answers. But these tests do not have quantitative answers. Projective techniques basically have qualitative and subjective answers. So a low reliability and a low validity is valued. Now let's look at the five types of projective techniques. First is known as the Rorschach inkblot test. Now Rorschach, Hermann Rorschach in Germany, developed this first technique. It's a very good technique in terms of assessing the person's unconscious mind. Very accurate and very detailed. It's almost comparative to MMPI of self-report. Very good in terms of its assessment value. Now this has 10 inkblot tests, which has 5 black and white, 2 red ink and 3 in pastel colors. Now when we talk about the Rorschach, you can look at the pattern which was drawn by dropping the ink on a piece of paper and folding the paper to get a symmetrical pattern. Now this has 2 stages. First is performance proper. Subjects are shown the cards and asked to tell what they see. So as many responses that the subject can give in this will be highly useful. Second stage after having the responses is inquiry, where a detailed report of the responses is taken. For instance, a participant says that I see a bat in the figure. So the participant is expected to explain what are the features because of which the participant is able to observe a bat in the picture. Because this has my own creativity, my own interpretation. The person who is doing the test does not know what is being measured, unlike a self-report measure where it is very clear. The questions indicate what will it measure. So this is able to deal with all the weaknesses of a self-report measure, but it has its own lacunas. Now this test has an interpretation which is basically subjected to a lot of detailed analysis in terms of very detailed manual and very good unconscious detailing and answers. Let's move on to the second test, which is TAT. TAT refers to thematic apperception test developed by Morgan and Murray. Now, thematic means we understand the themes. For example, if I show you the card, it has a theme which is being identified. The participant is expected to write a story looking at this picture, a story which should have a lot of questions, basically 4 questions. What is happening in this picture? What led up to the picture? What are the characters thinking and feeling? And what do you think is the future outcome of this particular situation? So based on these 4 questions, the participant develops a story. Now, this test is relatively more structured than the Rorschach test because it shows human figures. Also, this test has 30 cards in total, one blank card which is given at the end. Now, these 30 cards are based on gender, male, female, that is males and boys will have certain set of cards, girls and females will have certain set of cards, and then universal cards which are meant across the gender. In total, 20 cards are selected, some from the gender and the others as universal cards, which are meant for all. Now, total, once the 20 cards are given, at the end, there's a blank card on which it is expected that the person's unconscious desires will be pictured or projected, which will give a final theme. For instance, a lot of stories written by the subject or the participant shows a lot of aggressive need or aggressive theme. It could also show any other theme of, let's say, affiliation or society, how much attached the person is to the society. Now, this is a standard procedure of doing the test. The Indian adaptation was developed by Uma Chaudhary. Let's move on to the third one. It is the picture frustration study. Now, this test is developed by Rosenweg, which shows a person who is calling attention to a frustrating situation, and the participant has to respond as to what this particular cartoon will reply in response to the first person's statement. Now, this will analyze the degree and the direction of aggression, and it is very useful to identify from the cartoonic figures, because if I am supposed to respond, I will not respond looking at my own reaction, but I will very well respond for somebody else. So I can project my own unconscious onto somebody else, assuming that it's somebody else's response and not mine. Now here, the Indian adaptation is by Parikh. Uday Parikh developed it. And this test examines the focus is basically on the object or the person and his frustration or a constructive solution to the problem. So I as a participant, do I only call attention to a frustrating situation, or do I only display my aggression, its nature will be studied, or do I give a constructive solution to the problem? So my approach to handling an aggressive situation is being studied in Rosenweg's picture frustration test developed by Rosenweg. Fourth test is a sentence completion test. Now, this test has stems, which are few starting statements, and they are incomplete statements which have to be completed with whatever first statement comes to mind. For instance, the statement says, "My father." Now, for this statement, everybody's unconscious mind is going to give a different answer. And this is the beauty of this test, where we have the stem or the first part, which is suggestive of the unconscious desires or conflicts. Sentence incompletion test. Now, in this also, the type of ending reveals the subject's unconscious, underlying attitudes, motivations, and conflicts. Last projective technique that we have to cover is draw a person test. Now, this particular test is not a drawing test. It is rather a test which helps one draw out any imaginary figure or any imaginary person. Now, when we draw out a figure, we normally give an imaginary age to it, and we also give an imaginary name to it. A story around this is constructed. And this test shows a lot of aspects about the unconscious and also the opposite gender the person is asked to draw. For instance, a 7-year-old child tries to analyze the figure with a name and of the opposite gender. Let's say a girl is drawing the figure and draws a boy first, and then the age is 7 and she draws a boy of 5 years. So that is having a very conclusive evidence from the unconscious point of view. Now for this, a sheet, a pencil and eraser is provided to draw a person, but of course this is not a drawing test. And then the opposite gender is drawn with a story. Let's look at the interpretative value. The omission of facial features suggests highly conflict-ridden interpersonal relationships. So, for instance, a person did not draw the nose, that shows that the person is having interpersonal relationship problems. Graphic emphasis on the neck indicates lack of control over the impulses. So, such people who have a lot of emphasis on the neck will basically meaning thereby that a lot of impulse control is required. The person may just blurt out anything, the person may just do things that he or she likes without thinking about the consequences. Disproportionately large head in the figure drawn indicates organic brain damage, that is biological brain damage. Let's move on to the behavioral analysis. Now, these basically techniques are taken from the behavioral approach. We have again five techniques here. First is interview. Now, interview involves talking to the subject for analysis of his responses for personality assessment. Now, this can be normal face-to-face interaction to collect data about the person. For instance, in a clinic, a patient comes in and the patient's behavior is analyzed through interview. So, face-to-face direct questions are asked, which can happen in two manner. One could be structured or standardized, the other could be unstructured or unstandardized. A structured test has a fixed set of questions which are meant for everybody. So, any psychological test, when we use for a structured interview, which has a fixed set of questions, a case profile is taken with a fixed set of questions. Let's say I start with the family background, the childhood, the hobbies, the basic behavior pattern, that is fixed. It is structured. Unstructured have the advantage that a lot of in-depth probing can be done. Something that is not clear, the words can be changed. The answers can be probed in depth, something that is not clear to the interviewer. That is the advantage of it. And advantages in general of interview, it's very objective comparison of persons. It uses rating scales and of course, it is very, very objective. Second one is observation. It requires careful training, that's one prerequisite. Detailed guidelines is required as to what behavior is being measured and it has to be carefully designed. Disadvantages, very, very time consuming and demanding. Maturity of the observer is a precondition. So, no subjective biases should be there. First, I should know what I am measuring and then I should not have my own value judgments or impressions of the other person. Very, very objective. Involvement, presence of the person may contaminate the test results also. Although observation, normal observation and observation as a scientific method is different because it follows a systematic process. But even then, a lot of training is required, a lot of grooming is required, maturity of the observer is also important. Behavioral ratings basically rate people on a number of qualities. For instance, a person going abroad gives a criteria for the university and the rating is done. What is the level of leadership in the person is rated on a scale of 1 to 10. Its disadvantages, halo effect is one. Suppose I presume a child is a good leader. I will give qualities which are positive related to that. So, I will assume that overall the person is very good. Middle category bias basically talks about the fact that I am only considering average person. I am not considering the extremes. So, if I say I am not sure about the high category of leadership, I just say the person is average. So, that is average middle category bias or I avoid giving higher or lower grades. Last two are nomination and situational stress test. Nomination is basically when I am trying to nominate a certain person for play or study or creative task. So, you choose a certain person with whom you would like to do a certain task. That is nomination and this obviously has biases. Last is situational stress test where in a particular situation you are doing let's say a role play. Somebody who is learning pilot training is taken to stipulated, you know, a simultaneous process where he's using the aircraft, a simulated aircraft and learning it. So, it can be, let's say somebody going for the interview, there's a barrier and the person falls down with all his material. The reaction is being tested by the interviewer. A person says, I'm very stress-free. But when the person falls down, is very embarrassed and has a negative reaction. or in the army, such tests are used. That is, situations are given and the stress level is, or any other variable is tested. With that, we wind up for today's lecture. Today, we understood the major aspect of projective techniques and we covered the behavioral assessment techniques. That's about it for today. Thank you.